everyone, and welcome to Ask the Advisor. My name is Dr. Matthew Costello, and I'm the Chief Education Officer for the White House Historical Association. We're so excited to have launched a new game in collaboration with iCivics called Brief the Chief, where students take on the important job of advising different presidents through historical events and challenges with an emphasis on talking to people in and around the White House and using evidence-based reasoning to provide the president with a critical briefing. The game is available now on the iCivics website, as well as the App Store and Google Play, and is also supported with an extension pack for teachers that include additional activities and learning tools to reinforce key game concepts. By playing the game, you all will become presidential advisors to Thomas Jefferson, Abraham Lincoln, and Lyndon Johnson. And to better prepare you for this role, we are joined today by two real-life presidential advisors, Anita McBride and Tina Tchen. Anita McBride previously served as an assistant to President George W. Bush and chief of staff to First Lady Laura Bush. She is an executive in residence at the Center for Congressional and Presidential Studies at American University, where she leads the First Lady's Initiative and established the First Lady's Association for Research and Education. She is also the co-author of two books on First Ladies. Tina Tchen previously served as assistant to President Barack Obama and chief of staff to First Lady Michelle Obama, as well as executive director of the White House Council on Women and Girls. She is now executive vice president and chief strategy and impact officer for the Obama Foundation. But most importantly, Anita and Tina also serve on the board of directors for the White House Historical Association. Thank you both for joining us today for this conversation. I'd like to start today's conversation with both of you asking about really the journey. So how did you come to work at the White House?
Thank you, Matt. Thanks for hosting us. This is really fun to do this with students and to share our experience working for a president of the United States. I started in the most basic way as possible. I was a campaign volunteer in 1980 when I was a senior in college. And then the candidate won. It was Ronald Reagan for president and George H.W. Bush for vice president. And I moved to Washington wanting to work in government. It was a little bit of time before I was able to do that. By 1984, I worked again on the campaign and then was hired to the White House in the most basic of jobs, and that was reading the mail. I was in the mail room and then had many years of experience after that.
Thank you, Matt. I love being here talking to students and giving them a chance to be a presidential advisor through the game. My path to the White House was very unexpected. I was a longtime lawyer in Chicago practicing law, but one of the things I did through my entire career was be active in local politics here in Chicago. And it's somewhere along the way in that journey over 30 years that I met a very young and up-and-coming public official in Chicago by the name of Barack Obama and his incredibly talented wife, Michelle Obama. Always supported his campaigns, served with Mrs. Obama. I was on the board of trustees for the University of Chicago Medical Center when she was working there. Obviously very active in his U.S. Senate race and then his presidential race. And it was a bit of a surprise when, you know, after he won, I remember it vividly, just before Thanksgiving in 2008, when I got the call and would I consider moving my family across the country to D.C. To join his administration. And really, when the president of the United States calls you to come to service, you kind of go, no matter what else is going on in your life.
We have a question from Aubrey.
Hi, I'm Aubrey from Rochester Hills, Michigan. I'm wondering what inspired you to pursue your job in the government?
Aubrey, I had not planned to work in government. I mean, the campaign gave me an experience on the political side of things, which I found exciting, and then moved to Washington, as I mentioned. And I think what inspired me was actually an experience that I had living outside of the United States when I was a junior in college. It was 1979, and a very pivotal event in world history happened. It's when the American hostages were taken in Iran, and it really changed my view of how much more I needed to really understand about our country, our government, our place in the world. And so coming back to finish school at University of Connecticut. As I mentioned, that's when the campaign was happening. And I joined the campaign to just be a volunteer and have some exposure to politics. And when the candidate won, you know, it is a lot more fun to be on a winning campaign. I've been on losing campaigns too. But the experience was really life-changing for me. And the move to Washington, just where local news is national news and you're really surrounded by it every single day, whether it's in the media or the people around you, that was a very interesting experience for me. And it made our government and our politics and the people who serve much more, I connected with it a lot more. And so that's why I wanted to pursue an opportunity to work in our government and see how I can make a contribution.
Well, Aubrey, you know, working in the White House was the first time I ever worked in government for my day job. But being involved in politics, being especially involved in doing work on women and girls, I had always been an outside advocate. That started right when I graduated from college, and I got very involved in Illinois in the effort to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment, because Illinois had not ratified the Equal Rights Amendment back in 1978. And that just inspired me to keep working in politics. But you can see that, you know, while you're advocating from the outside, really enacting policies and being able to do the work that you care about happens when you're in government. Mm-hmm. So I was really excited to then move from the position of advocating with people, trying to get them to do what I hoped they would do, to being inside, as you will now find in your game, and advising the president on actually what to do, because the president can issue executive orders. The president can pass legislation with Congress acting. That's actually, government is where policy actually happens.
We have another student question. This one is from Jocelyn.
I'm Jocelyn, and I'm from Rochester Hills, Michigan, and I'm wondering, what kinds of tasks do you perform when working in the White House?
Well, this is sort of an interesting question for me to answer, Jocelyn, because I did work in the White House three different times for three different presidents, and I had different responsibilities in each of those times that I served there. I mentioned to you earlier, the first task that I had as right out of college was working in the mail room and reading mail. But what was important about that was this was mail that was coming in from all over the country, and in some cases from around the world as well. People that were writing to the president, they wanted to be heard by the president. They would complain about what he was doing, or they would thank him for what he was doing. But what was important about that is the president would see a sampling of the mail that came in, and that was our job, to make sure that they saw what was positive and what was negative. Because when you're working in the White House, and the president in particular, they live in a bit of a bubble. It's a secure bubble. They're very busy. There's advisors around them, bringing them the information that they need. But unless they're out on the road, it's hard to connect with the average American and the average citizen. So this was a way we could help bring that very valuable point of view or valuable points of view to a president. So that was my first job. But that was in the Reagan administration. And then in the George H.W. Bush administration, I moved into other roles. I was in management and administration, and which is the organization and operations of the White House. I was in personnel. I ultimately became director of personnel. So that was helping to bring people on board to the White House as employees to work for the president. And I did that almost 6 years. Then when President Clinton was elected in 1992, I left the White House because I too was a political appointee. So I was hired by President Reagan and President George H.W. Bush. President Clinton came in and brought his own people, which is the way our system works. There are people who work administration to administration, their career staff that stay there and keep the presidency running, but I was not one of those. And so I left for 8 years and came back in 2000 when George W. Bush was elected. And I started again in personnel because that's what I knew how to do. But then I went to work at the State Department to work for Secretary Colin Powell. Got some experience that I really had wanted to work in a foreign affairs agency. And then I came back to the White House in 2004 when Laura Bush hired me to be her chief of staff and to work with her on the goals that she had to support the administration and to support the president. So that job was very different. And as Tina will share with you too, when we get to that multifaceted, just like the role of a first lady, you can go from planning a state dinner in the morning to planning a visit overseas to a war zone, even in our case, three times in the same day. So it's a very multifaceted experience. And I got to learn a lot about the 18 acres of the White House and everything that goes on there.
So the thing about being a senior advisor to the president is there's actually not very many of them. The White House staff is actually smaller than you would expect it to be. You get to call upon experts throughout the entire federal government, but the actual number of people who are the president's advisors who work within the White House is actually quite small, which requires those advisors, the ones who do the job best, to be really good multitaskers, to be really people who can go from one thing to another. And I had two roles as Mrs. Obama's chief of staff, and then I was also the president's advisor on all things that had to do with women and girls, all of the gender policy in the Obama administration. So, you know, every day was different from the other. Most days were very different at the end of the day than what you thought they were going to be at the beginning of the day, because things happen, you know, the breaking news happens and you have to be ready to respond if the Supreme Court comes out with a decision or it's something, you know, a disaster happens somewhere and you have to respond. And you have to quickly, for example, put together a trip, which we had to do many times to console families who had lost loved ones. Or you could have a day, you know, as, you know, Anita mentioned, you could be planning, you know, the dinner setting for a state dinner, and then walking into the Oval Office to brief the president on what we should be doing in the Affordable Care Act around women's health. You have to be able to do both of those things and, you know, be able to treat everyone who comes in front of you with an equal amount of respect, whether it's kids who are coming in to talk about Let's Move, you know, and their ability to eat healthier with Mrs. Obama, to heads of state who were coming in to greet us. And I felt that you were always representing the president and the first lady. And I felt, you know, and it was very important to really make sure everyone who came to the White House or everyone who was going to engage with me in the place of the president or the first lady, you know, felt equally respected and equally heard and equally their views taken into account in what we were doing, because that's one of the things that's really special, I think, about our democracy, and particularly special about the White House, is that it truly is the people's house, as Mrs. Kennedy said. And it is a place where everyone in the country and everyone around the world should be able to come and make their views known and make themselves heard and be respected.
You both have touched on this, the idea that every day is different. You know, you wake up and this is what you expect the day to be, and this is how it ends. But you both have touched on this idea that you need to be very flexible. You need to be able to absorb information quickly. So let's just say, somebody's applying for this job, and, you know, what skills or abilities are they looking for when they hire, a president or a first lady, when they're hiring a presidential advisor or an advisor to the first lady? What skills or abilities are going to be particularly important?
Well, one interesting thing that you mentioned is, you know, applying for this job. I mean, neither one of us applied for our job. That is sort of an interesting point as well. I think the president needs to know and the first lady needs to know that you are going to be prepared to know how to do your job. You're going to be honest with them. You're going to be willing to bring them information sometimes that they don't want to hear or that is hard to hear. And when you're managing, you know, a staff as well, like Tina and I did, that you are managing them, that you're knowing what everybody is doing. You're cognizant, respectful of their role, because it is a team. To be able to work in the White House, nobody can do these tasks alone. The president can't do it alone. They need people who are working with each other, you know, and some people have different points of view, even in the White House. But as Tina mentioned, too, it's respecting what those points of view are. And I think a president and first lady want to know that they have people around them who are going to work really hard, who are not going to let them be surprised by things. You know, as Tina mentioned, you're aware of breaking news. You have to be able to have good judgment on what you need to bring to them right away, or what could wait. Understand just how all the components in the White House work together, and be able to really lead a team to help them.
The senior advisor role, as Anita said, those roles are not ones you apply for. Right. Those are ones in which frequently it is, you know, as was my case, people that the president and the first lady know already, because it's very personal. You know, these are people who are really close, and the president and the first lady need to rely on what the advisors are saying. They need to be able to be comfortable with them in difficult moments, to be able to express themselves in difficult moments, and have the advisor be able to be frank and honest with them in difficult moments. But that's not always the case. There are a lot of folks who came and became senior advisors during the Obama administration who the president and the first lady didn't necessarily know ahead of time, but proved themselves either by what they were doing in jobs they had held on the Hill in Congress or jobs elsewhere in the White House as being people who were expert and diligent and, you know, most importantly, had good judgment, and were able to exercise that. And, you know, the President Obama placed a high premium also on teamwork. You know, we were known for no drama Obama, but that's really true, where he, you know, really wanted people who would work together as a team, who would be able to mesh with the other senior advisors, who would be able to bring out the best in the junior staff and the other staff, not just in the White House, but throughout the federal government, to do hard things in very limited timeframes oftentimes. And to, you know, be, you know, make sure that the president had all of the information he needed to make what are often very complex and difficult decisions.
We have another student question. This one is from Dan.
Hi, I'm Dan. I'm from Rochester Hills, Michigan, and I'm wondering, what does daily life look like in the White House?
All right. Daily life in the White House is very unpredictable. Your morning, you could be prepared with a long to-do list that you left for yourself the night before and come in that next morning and some breaking news or some urgent situation may have arise that you have to be able to pivot to that. So this goes back to something that both Tina and I have said a couple of times, is being prepared, being flexible, and really being able to respond to the moment and need at the time. I think, you know, one of the other things that has been alluded to in this conversation is the reputation that one has to be able to manage the high intensity nature of working in the White House, and being able to, you know, build a set of skills that can be very adaptable to White House life. So the days are always different, but they're always very interesting. And I think, you know, some things you're planning ahead, other things come to you in an urgent moment, and you have to know how to respond to that as well. But the tasks are they're varied. But again, each day does require you to be prepared to read your notes, to read your briefing papers, to make sure that the first lady or the president, if you're briefing him on an issue, that the information that you are supplying through all the proper channels that it takes to get to him are accurate. You know, accuracy in information of the White House is really important. The one thing that I think we always felt every single day, the stakes are very high. The news is watching you constantly. The media is looking to tell stories where things don't work as well when you're trying to work really hard in the White House. to get the messages out that are important for the president, important for the first lady, on the myriad of things that they are trying to accomplish.
Dan, let me answer your question by trying to just paint a picture. I'll try to paint a picture of just sort of how some of the daily tasks were. So really, literally the first thing I would do when I got out of bed was to check what used to be a BlackBerry, then became an iPhone during the course of our administration. And I had to carry two of them, you know, at least, sometimes more, but there was always the work phone and then there was the personal phone. And you always had to check the work phone as things were coming in. Because that was the very first, you needed to know while you were sleeping what had happened. And more often than not, something had happened that you need to know. And you needed to know that before you got to the White House, which for Anita and I as senior advisors was 7:30 in the morning for the 7:30 chief of staff meeting. It's a well-known meeting in White House. It has carried across administrations where the president's chief of staff gathers the most senior advisors for a meeting at 7:30. Then there's a broader meeting of department heads at 8:30 every morning. And you needed to arrive at that 7:30 morning already knowing what had already happened, what all the headlines were, having read the clips, hopefully, if you had been able to do that as well, because we all got, thankfully, we all now get them electronically as opposed to what we used to do in the old days. Anita and I are old enough to remember when clips were actually clipped out of actual physical newspapers and you had to flip through the pages to get those. And you have to arrive knowing that, because that is what's going to allow you to, you know, respond to whatever's different about what the day was supposed to be. You have to be able to brief the rest of the senior advisors on what is happening with your particular part of the White House. In my case, making sure everyone throughout the White House knew what we were planning in the First Lady's team, whether Mrs. Obama was traveling that week, whether we were going to hold a press conference on Let's Move or do something with veterans and military families, whether we were going to have members from Congress over for some event, because that could affect what the congressional team was working on with respect to advocacy on a bill. I was very proud of the way we were able to mesh what we did in the East Wing, as the First Lady's office is known as, you know, with what went on in the West Wing to be supportive. Because one of the things Mrs. Obama always said is there's only one guy who's elected in this building, and everything that we do should be in service of the president's agenda, because that is the agenda the American people voted for. And if we're not doing that, then the rest of us in the White House, if you're doing something that doesn't relate to that, you got to be thinking twice about why you are spending time, why you would ask the president, the first lady to spend time on something that is not furthering that agenda. So that's how the day started. And then it just takes off from there. And it was a lot of walking. I got a lot of steps in because our office was on the far east end of the 18 acres. I would frequently have meetings in the Eisenhower, office building, which is across the driveway from the West Wing, or on various floors of the West Wing. And I tried to always get there in person because it was important to represent the First Lady or to represent the Council on Women and Girls in these meetings with other agencies, with other advisors, because you had to be in the room. There is something about that song from Hamilton. There, you have to be in the room to make your particular viewpoint known. And that's an important part of being an advisor, is to speak up and to be in the room and to be prepared when the moment comes up, so that as policies are getting distilled on their way up to the president, that's the most important time to have your voice known. By the time it gets to the Oval, all of those issues should have been addressed by the staff on the way up. So, you know, what Anita said about being prepared, I would add to that using your voice, you know, at the moments in which you need to speak up and express that viewpoint so that it gets taken into account.
And I would like to add to that, and Tina made a really good point. You are, in these roles, the representative of your principal. And people in the room know that and expect you are speaking on their behalf. And that's a level of trust and responsibility that is very inherent to these jobs as senior advisor. And the other point she made about being there, going in person to these meetings is very, very valuable. You have to manage your time in the White House, and time is the most precious asset for you, but certainly is the most precious asset for the First Lady or the President, definitely. You know, one of the chief of staffs I used to work for used to say when requests would come into him for people to see the President, he would ask, "Do you need to see the President or do you want to see the President?" If you want to see the president, you likely won't. If you need to see the president, you will, which means, you know, managing their time for important things is really critical.
So the work that you've both done in the White House and in government has been obviously very important. There's a lot of important responsibilities that go with these roles. And this is very serious business, but I also know that there's camaraderie, there's teamwork, you make friends. And so I was just curious, either one of you had a favorite funny story or a favorite memory that you'd like to share with us about your time working in the White House.
Well, there is a camaraderie that comes with working in the White House. That's for sure. The days are, you know, really long and intense. But I think sometimes it helps. Some of the best memories, often when you are traveling on the road and you get outside of Washington and you get outside of the White House, and, you know, it takes a big team of people to plan a trip for a president and first lady. There's a lot of bonding that goes on those trips, whether it's domestically or traveling internationally. And you do have a lot of memories of the people that you meet, the fun you can have on the road, even though it's so busy. I think, you know, one memory that I always have, always had, was not really a great one, but it is kind of funny, missing a motorcade overseas, because I did not set my clock to the right time. We had made multiple stops across the continent of Africa. The time zones changed, and I was just tired, I guess. And if it hadn't been for a really nice Secret Service agent who noticed I was missing, it could have been a disaster. I could have been left behind, because when you're with the principal, it's the principal's schedule. It's the protectee, the president or the first lady. That is the priority. And as staff, Tina could tell you, no matter how close you are collateral. And so I made it to the plane. Let's just say that, but it was touch and go.
So there are a lot of funny moments, a lot of things that were fun. I think the one that I'm thinking of right now was, you know, and has a lot to give Mrs. Obama credit for being just a good sport about trying new things. You know, we came of age in our White House with social media. You know, it was the first thing. I remember I, as the lawyer in me, was like, we are never going on Twitter and Instagram. What are you talking about? You know, we can't review presidential statements out there. Our younger staff wisely sort of, you know, advised us that if you wanted to reach young people, which we were trying to do, that's what we would have to do. And then it's the unpredictability about people out on the road. So putting those two thoughts together, we were doing our initiative. We had launched our initiative to support adolescent girls' education in the second term, Let Girls Learn. We were out in Los Angeles at an event, and in the photo line was the terrific composer, Diane Warren, who is just, you know, fabulous. And she, Diane, had actually written a song for Let Girls Learn, which we used in a video that Zendaya and others did for us to promote adolescent girls' education. So Diane's in the photo line with Mrs. Obama. She says to me beforehand, oh, I think she should do carpool karaoke, you know, with James Corden. Like, and I'm saying, like, Diane, do not suggest carpool karaoke to Mrs. Obama. It's like impossible. There's no way we could do it. We can't have her driving around in the streets. Like, do not mention it. Diane is irrepressible. So of course she mentions it. And she's standing right there. Oh, I talked to Tina about this. Mrs. Obama's like, oh, this is a great idea. So then when things like that happen, your job as chief of staff is then to make it happen. So James Corden's team is, of course, delighted. That was not the problem. The problem was, how would you figure out how to film Mrs. Obama in a moving car, right, doing carpool karaoke? And the solution that our team came up with was, with Secret Service, you know, all involved, when Corden's team was to bring their car, which is tricked out with like 20 different cameras, and you don't see the cameras. They're very skilled at this, but they're placed all over this not very large car so they can capture all the moments, into the White House. It had to be screened. And then Mrs. Obama with James Corden, and then Missy Elliott jumped in the back seat at one moment, just drove around the driveway repeatedly. That was how carpool karaoke came to be, driving around the airport. And I'm watching, I'm sitting in the back with the producers in the chase car, like watching this happen as we're doing the cuts, and we're just circling the driveway one after another. But it came out pretty well. It was very popular. It sort of got the news out, but, you know, problem solving with Secret Service on how to capture those moments, and having a principal like Mrs. Obama, who was game to do anything, was what made that happen.
It's a really great story. And it really, the underscores the point at the White House, you really can make anything happen. The staff can pull together. It does take everybody to work together. But as Tina mentioned, you have to have a willing principal. And that is such a great example of connecting with people too, because that was so popular and so fun to watch.
We have another student question. This one is from Marin.
Hi, I'm Marin from Rochester Hills, Michigan, and I'm wondering what the most important requirement is to work in the White House.
I would say if we get to say one thing, have to be really willing to work very hard and realize that this is a short time that you get to be in the White House to accomplish big goals that the president has and that the people elected him to do. And so you have to oftentimes put your personal life a bit on hold in order to accomplish what needs to be done. And it just takes every ounce of your energy to do it. So to be energetic and be willing to devote the time that it takes to work in the White House.
The one quality probably that you need to have is good judgment, you know, and have had a lot of experience where you've been able to test your judgment in different circumstances, because good judgment isn't necessarily something you're born with. And it actually has to be developed and honed over time, you know, responding to difficult situations so that you learn what's really an important fact and what's really not so important. And look, I kept learning all during my time at the White House. It's not like I arrived with a perfectly well set of judgment and experience to apply to the White House, because it's very unique. I used to tell people who arrived at the White House, no matter how experienced they were, there is no other job on the planet that prepares you to actually work in the White House. There's just, it is unique in terms of the challenges, in terms of the pressure and the stakes involved, and the scrutiny. It's not just that the press are kind of watching after an announcement comes out. The press actually have offices on the White House grounds. So while there, you know, are certain areas that they can't walk into, it is not uncommon for you to walk as you're leaving the building to go get your lunch, and you're carrying a memo with you that you were going to read while you're over lunch, that some reporter's going to see it under your arm and take a picture if you, you know, we're so, not careful to have it not on the blank side of the page or in a folder. And which many people learn that lesson, right, is that they can't just carry their papers around the building, because who thinks of that, right, unless you're at the White House, where there's folks watching not only the president's every move, but every move of anyone who is in the president's orbit. And that goes for the most junior staffer all the way up to the senior advisor. And so learning that judgment and taking those lessons to heart over time, I think is perhaps one of the most important qualities.
Our final question for this program: as students prepare to play Brief the Chief, do you have any other additional advice on how they can succeed in working in the White House?
I would say your reputation is everything when you're working in the White House. Set high standards for yourself so that your principal knows that they can trust you, that you'll exercise good judgment. As Tina has said, you work well with your colleagues. This is a collaborative effort when you're in the White House. No one does it alone. And you don't have to know the answer to every single question, but you want to find out. You want to do your homework. You want to make sure you have all the best information in front of you when you're briefing your principal. And again, I would say at the end of the day, your reputation is what differentiates you when you're working at the White House. People have to know they can trust your word, your judgment. And that also, the other thing too that I found was really important to succeed at the White House is if you've made a mistake, own up to it and don't put the blame on someone else. Be honest and trustworthy that way, people, because nobody's ever always perfect all the time. So if something happens, own up to it, move on, fix it, let others know that you can be trusted to be honest in that way.
Well, I think as students prepare to play the game, you know, the one really huge thing about being an advisor is you are there to gather all the information because the president can't gather it himself, right? You need to really talk to everyone, talk to people who have opposing viewpoints, people especially who might hold a different viewpoint than you might have if you've got your own opinion about the question at hand, because it's important to test that opinion of yours against what other people are saying. And that's what the president expects, not for you to just walk in and say, I think you should do this, but that viewpoint has been tested and that you believe that it works because you know the opponents have an alternative position that doesn't work for these sets of reasons. And I would add that it's not just gathering facts. As the senior, that's what the junior staff do that. The senior advisors have to take the facts and synthesize the facts into an opinion and a recommendation for the president with a pretty clear eye to what the opposing viewpoint would be, a pretty really clear eye what the risks would be, the risks to the policy, the risks to other positions that the president may have, the risks to the presidency itself, you know, and re-election or what may happen in the legacy of the president. Those are all the things that have to be taken into an account. And you, as the senior advisor, are expected to be the one who can take all of those into account and who has done the legwork. It's a tremendous amount of legwork to put together an opinion for the president on anything, because you really do, if you're doing your job right, you have tested the waters in every possible place where you can. Because the time when something bad happens is when you do take a position and there was that one person you didn't talk to, or that one memo you didn't take the time to read that had the really bad fact about the person that you're about to appoint to a position, or a new policy that you're going to, you know, reach out on, that winds up being the thing that blows up. And that's what many of us who worked in the White House sort of lived in dread of and drove, you know, the amount of time and hours that we spent doing the work. When you feel that responsibility to the president and to the country in doing this work, it fuels you to really turn over every rock, look at every piece of information and advice before you go into the Oval Office with your opinion.
Well, Anita and Tina, thank you both so much for joining us today and sharing your knowledge and experience with us all.
Thank you.
I'd also like to thank our partner iCivics for helping us create Brief the Chief, the students who have already played the game and submitted questions for this program, and teachers across the country for recognizing the value in this game, both for learning about the White House and White House history. Now, I want to encourage everyone to listen carefully, ask good questions, and use sound judgment in making your recommendations. Now go out and brief the chief. Have a good day.